But now we are almost coming to the closure of the theory portion of that. We don't have any exact demarcation between theory and practice as it is. However, the details of kalas, perhaps they will be concluded by this session and art appreciation. And I'll be telling something about Indian art's great sources, three great authors, the Rishi Kavis, as we can say, Vyasa, Valmiki and Kalidasa, in the future deliberations. In this session, I'll be dealing something with the arts. We have all known Kala. In the very first day itself, I told Kal, Gatau, Sankhyane, Kshepe, like that, starting from the etymology, and also Saundarya, coming from the word Sundara, Samyak, Undi, Kledayati, Ardrayati, and Samyak, Driyate, Nirikshate. In all these ways, we'll be having art appreciation and concept of beauty. And now, many of us would have heard that there are 64 arts. And 64 is a magic number. Not any specific number or any such thing, but we can know there are very many versions of that. Most famous four versions of these arts that has been given by four works. One is the well-known Vatsyayana's Kama Sutra, and I also told how Kama is a very broad-based term, and that includes every legitimate enjoyment of life as well, and a cultured way of appreciating things. And then we have the Prabandha Kosha of Merutunga. Merutunga, a great Jain scholar, hailed from Gujarat, medieval times Gujarat. And in Prabandha Kosha, we are going to have these things. I'm sorry, not Merutunga. Merutunga's Prabandha Chintamani. Prabandha Kosha is by Hemachandra. Hemachandra was known as Kalikala Sarvajna. He wrote on every subject which came into his purview, whether it is grammar or prosody or aesthetics or poetics or Jainology or whatever, lexicography, dictionaries, everything he wrote in various Prakrits and in Sanskrit. He was a poet scholar. He was known as Kalikala Sarvajna. And in our tradition, we have something like Sarvatantra Swatantra, who are adept in all systems of philosophies, and Shatadhika Grantha Kartaraha, who have written hundreds of works, literally hundreds of works. That is the Vijayindra from the Dvaita school of philosophy, or the Vedanta.Deshika from the Vishishta Dvaita school of philosophy, or Appaya Dikshitendra from Advaita school of philosophy, or Samanta Bhadracharya, Merutunga, like that, so many people from Jaina. Every tradition we have, and one of the earliest known Sarvatantra Swatantra is Vachaspati Mishra, who has competed upon every well-known system of philosophy. And Abhinavagupta is another great personality in our aesthetics and philosophy. He studied under 80 gurus, it seems. Tasyame sarvashishyasya nopadesha daridrata. Me being student to everyone, I have no dearth for information. And they are so confident, and justly so. And his befitting student, Kshemendra, he was also sarva manishi shishyaha. He himself declares himself as a wonderful student to all scholars. And all walks of life they have written. And with so much of compassion and concern for knowledge and perpetuation of that, they have written. For example, Kshemendra of 10th century and 11th century Kashmir. He says, he writes concise forms of Ramayana, Mahabharata, Bharatkatha, the three great works dealing with all the Purusharthas. Ramayana and Mahabharata mainly deal with Dharma, Artha and Moksha. Well, Kama has been profusely dealt with in the Bharatkatha tradition of Gunadhyaya. That is the storehouse of so many wonderful stories and such thing. Then we have he writing about Banabhatta's Kadambari and so many works dealing with the upliftment of the society, and then pointing down their angularities, crookedities, and making mark of that satirical way of treating the society. All these things have been done by Kshemendra. What I am saying is, ultimately based on these things, our society since time immemorial was dynamic, was self-correcting, was always after knowledge and beauty. So The great hallmarks of Sanatana Dharma lies in this. Hallmarks of Sanatana Dharma lie in these concepts like production, perpetuation, cultivation, and appreciation of knowledge in any form, whether it is social or normative or physical or biological or even wisdom in the form of beauty and experience. All these things we see, and that is seen very well in the feature of kalas, number of kalas. And there are very many books also. Perhaps the first book written in English on kalas is by Ambale Venkat Subbaya from Karnataka. Before a century he wrote the kalas. It was a path-breaking work. He did his doctorate in Germany, and that work, the kalas, is the doctoral thesis, where he calls out from the primary sources how these colors are envisaged. And then we have many works also. We have several works available, works of Salatore, Indudhar, and others. And colors can be divided into so many ways. And all colors are not fine arts as we understand now. There are several crafts, several commercial arts, martial arts, sports, and many. This broad-based classification I have given: Lalita Kalaha, Kushala Kalaha, Vinoda Kalaha, Krida Kalaha, the first tier, and the second one, Yuddha Kalaha, Vanijya Kalaha, and Sankirna Kalaha. Every category, every division will end up in miscellaneous, where none can be accommodated in any other divisions. They will all be going to miscellaneous. That's the big appendix. In the Lalita Kalas, we have fine arts. We all know music, dance, poetry, painting, like that. And in the Kushala Kalas, we have crafts. The distinction between Lalita Kala and Kushala Kala is, craft has an element of utility, but it will be beautiful to look at. For example, a very beautifully constructed pot is useful. The pitcher is useful to fetch water. At the same time, it has its own beauty in existence. Likewise, the carvings which are all done, whether the pillar or the beam or whatsoever, these are all coming under the crafts. In crafts, prayojana drishti is seen, utility is seen, but in Lalita Kala, it's just ananda. Our ancients, our people, they were known for both. Life should have some utility purpose also. Things should be utilitarian as well. And even there we should have beauty. Now, in the name of convenience and ease, we have completely just trimmed off all the wonderful angles, curves, and others. Dr. Anand Kumar Swami, he laments Indian craftsmen and transformation of nature in art and then civilization in such books. He shows how our past, our people earlier, they used to care so much for art in every aspect of life. Now, it is difficult to wash things like brass and copper, and that's why you go for steel. And even there, the carvings and all, they will not be handled very easily. They have to be cleansed with care, and they need a lot of attention and patience for maintaining. That's why we go to bald things. Earlier, a panchapatra or a uddharani or a cup or a plate or whatsoever, it used to have a lot of artistic feature. Whatever thing is there, it used to have a lot of carvings, designs, and such structures. Nowadays, we feel it is very difficult to handle. So we go to easy things. Even coming to the costumes also. It's so difficult to maintain a dhoti, and that's why men are going to 3/4 Bermuda and others. That is what we see. The comfort that dominates, ease that dominates the beauty. It is so difficult to maintain a sari. I know. It is so difficult to maintain a dhoti. But at least, if you don't enjoy the difficulty of maintaining, then we can't say much about arts. Art never lives in museums. Real life is what? The abode of art. In that sense, in museum, art means it is litlakara. It is past tense, perfect past tense, perfect indirect past tense. But we have to live. In that sense, day-to-day utility, that may mar our freshness of looking at things, but we are using those things. That has lot of impetus and that has lot of relevance. And in that sense, crafts have lot. The role of crafts is very much pronounced. And then we have the, we know the kalas, amusements. In amusements, there are several categories, indoor, outdoor, like that. And in these amusements, we'll be having again a lot of beauty. Here, overlapping here and there is always seen. Some of the amusements can come to sports. Here, sports mainly meaning outdoor. In amusements, we have something like ganjifa, cards, paramapada sopana, like that. Unfortunately, not much of work has been done in that regard. How many such amusements and how many such arts are described in our works, in our ancient texts, let alone in Sanskrit and Prakrit, in other regional languages, how they are brought out, and even today, how these things are seen. Here comes a lot of folk art. And in our tradition, there is nothing like untouchability regarding folk art. This has to be borne very well in mind. It is the malpractices of communists that has created artificial enemies and artificial walls. These people, they try to show that there is a distinct cleavage between the classical and folk arts. For that matter, we have two traditions like Margand, Deshi, one influencing the other. And they are not separate. When we realize a thing, then it becomes Marga. When we pick up a thing, it becomes Deshi. Drishyate sarvatra deshe deshe iti deshi and brugyate antaha iti marga. That which is searched within, that becomes marga. And that which is seen everywhere is deshi. Marga is the philosophical content and deshi is the actual practice. Marga is something like the inlaying oneness, unity, and deshi is the diversity that is expressed. And from Marga, you have Deshi and vice versa. And Marga, Deshi, both are very well preserved and detailed and delineated with a lot of detailed explanation in our classical texts. Because many people, they don't know, folk arts were completely ignored by Sanskrit scholars. They never care for that. It's a misnomer. You go to any of the musical texts and dance texts, Sangeeta Ratnakara, or Manasolasa, Sangeeta Raja, or Sangeeta Saramrita, n number of works, or Ashokamala's Nrityadhyaya, or Nritta Ratnavali, or else Bharatarnava, n number of works, both in music and dance. If you go to Prabandhadhyaya, connected with lyrics, you have so many Prabandhas which are even today practiced in folk. For example, in Marathi, there is a meter called Ovi, meant for lullaby songs. And this Ovi is explained in detail in Sangeeta Ratnakara. And in this Ovi meter only, the great Gyaneshwara, he wrote the Gyaneshwari, wonderful commentary, Vedantic commentary on the Bhagavad Gita. And then we have, when I remember Gyaneshwara, my phone is remembering Krishna. Then we have the Tripadis. Tripadi is one of the traditional folk meters of Kannada. Someshwara's Manasolasa speaks so many such Tripadis. And then there are some beautiful instances there. Cockfight is arranged. And the winning cock will be taken on position on an elephant back. You see the plight of elephant. The winner cock, the winning cock, will be taken elephant howdha procession. And then a variety of Tripadi by name Chitra has to be sung. And Tripadi, yena kena api talena giyate mata, that's what he says. These folk meters can be accommodated in any tala, and so variety of talas are present. I shall sing one Kannada Tripadi, and then you'll be knowing how in the same lyric, without hampering the lyrical beauty, literary beauty, can be sung in different talas. Tripadi means in Kannada, the name of Sarvajna comes to mind. He is known for composing thousands of Tripadis and teaching the world. Salava Kumba, the lyric just without Tala. Salava Kumbaga, Halogara Umbante, Saliga Bandu Sedavaga, Kibbadiya Kilu Muridante Sarvajna. Three lines. Now I shall sing in Aditala, Chatrashra. Kalava Kumbaga Haloga Rumbante, Saliga Bandu Selevaga, Saliga Bandu Selevaga Kibadiya Kilu Muridante Sarvajnyang. Now, Tishra. In Rupaka, Kalava Kumbaga Haloga Rumbante Kal Saliga Bandu Selevaga. That's how it goes. Now, Khanda. Salava Kumbaga Haloga Rumbante Saliga Bandu Selevaga. Like that. Now, Mishra. Salava kumbaga haloga rumbante saliga bandu selevaga. So, because of this flexibility, you'll be having so much of rhythmic variety. And such things are seen in folk meters. They are called Karnataka Vishaya Jati by Jaikirti. He in detail explains the folk meters. Hemachandra, in his Chandona Shasana, has devoted really so many number of pages for these things. And also Janashri, another metrical work dealing with prosody. Like that, folk lyrics and folk bandhas are never ignored. And also folk instruments. You go to Sangeet Ratnakara's Vadyadhyaya, or even Someshwara's Manasollasa or Abhilashitartha Chintamani, as it is mentioned, they are also Vadyadhyaya. You have so many such things. Whether it is the Edukkai of Kerala, or Runja of Karnataka, or it is the Dhakuli of Maharashtra, every such thing is explained in due details. It is Hudukka, Dhakuli, and then Yedaka, and then Kahala, Nisala, Panava, like that. So many such, Gomukha, Anaka, many such varieties. And again, various types of stringed instruments, starting from a single string, Ekatari, to many, Shatatari Veena, that is Santur. Every such things, how to construct them, how to play them, all are given. Some explanations may be clear, some may not be clear, but they are honest in giving due prominence, and also the details have been very well delineated. And then the dance movements also. All dance movements, whether it is the Bharatas Margan Ruttya or the regional Deshiyan Ruttyas, everything is seen. Kolatika or the Gaundali or Perini, like that we have several. And then even the Deshi terms have been used. Many of the terms are in Kannada. Much of the Deshi terms have been in Kannada, because we know that Vijayanagar and also earlier the Chalukyas and Rashtrakutas, they played a pivotal role in reconstructing the medieval culture of India. And because of that, so many Lakshya Lakshana Granthas are composed in Karnataka. Many of the works which belong to Sangeeta and Nritya are in Karnataka. And that's why Karnataka Sangeeta, the name came into existence. And even today in Tamil Nadu, the word Karnatakam is used for very traditional thing. Enna romba Karnatakama podave kattindirukkiye, very old style. Our pechu Karnatakam aachi. They are old style people. And even it is incorrigible, very difficult to understand, old, traditional. In Maharashtra also, Kanhadi Vithala we say. Oh, you are very clever and manipulating, I can't understand. You are very cryptic, that's how we say. Kanhadi Vithal, Kanhadi, Kannada. Like that, and even Rajashekar of medieval India, he says, these Karnataka people are known for producing wonderful plays, and every time they are bagging the trophies, and this time I will compose such a cryptic and tongue-twirling verse-embedded poem, Bala Ramayana, so that none from Karnataka can recite these verses and bag the prizes like that. Means they were known for that. In that sense, many of the terms. Karnataka laha, Mrichakatika, Shudraka says, Sagarva Sarva Karnata, Tankar Uttara Patina, like that Rajshekhar again says, the Kannada people are known for rendition of verses without any stage fear. That, in that time, Karnataka was not just restricted to one territory. We should not be language chauvinists. Our ancestors were never. Many languages, they coexisted at the same place. All languages used to be converging very beautifully. You just take an example of Krishnadevaraya. Krishnadevaraya basically is belonging to Tulu dynasty. Tulu means the language of coastal Karnataka. It's one among the five South Indian languages. I don't want to use the word Dravidian languages. One among the South Indian languages. He hails from Tulu Vamsha, Taulava. And he is Kannada Rama Ramana, as hailed in the inscriptions and all. Karnataadhishwara. And even his icon stands in front of the god of Tirupati. It goes by the name Krishnadeva Rayaru in Kannada script. So he is Kannada Raya. Because he ruled Hampi, Hampi-centric whole of South India. And he takes for his epic poem, one of the most scholarly work in Telugu, one among the best of the five Panchamahakavyas, Amukta Malyada, he takes theme from Tamil Nadu and then writes in Telugu. Perhaps if it were to be danced in Kerala, the whole circle would have been complete. Now I am saying that. And so it is complete. Our kings, our scholars, they never had such linguistic disparity. Here and there would have been some remote echoes and some remote other words, other way of looking at things. But the main, on the whole, it used to be always friendly and used to be optimistic and positive. In that way, when we see in the Vadyadhyayas of any Sangeeta and Nritya Shastra Granthas, we have reference to all classical and folk Vadyas. In the Western tradition, folk means that has no legacy, that has no written history, no documentation. But no such thing is seen in ours. Everything more or less is documented. And then we have the ragas. So many Deshi ragas are there. So many Marga ragas are there. And Deshi ragas become Marga raga. The minor ragas become major. And the major go to oblivion and become minor. All these things are present. And constantly we see the change of ragas. One thing, one raga like Deshakshi, how it almost ends up in becoming Shuddha Danyasi or Shuddha Saveri or Durga. It's a wonderful course to see. And then earlier, how was Hindolam? And now how it is Hindolam or Malcolm's? It is another study. And then region-based ragas. From the Surat of modern Gujarat, it was earlier called as Saurashtra. And we have a raga called Saurashtra. And Bangala, Shuddha Bangala, again belong to Bengal. And then Gowda, a part of Bengal. And Orissa. Gowda raga is Gowda raga. Ladayora Bheda. We have Gowda Mallar, one raga. And then Gowda, Kedara Gowda, Kannada Gowda, Narayana Gowda, like that the varieties. And also from Kamboja. Kamboja is the one of the northeastern provinces of northwestern provinces of India. Kamboja. And then one variety of that, Yarakal Kamboja, Yarakal Kamboji, that is Sanskritized or baptized as Yadukala Kamboji. But its real name is Yarakala. Yarakala means, these were the people who are inhabitants of Andhra Pradesh forest around Srishailam, and they had one variety of Kamboji, and that is called as Yarakala Kamboji. Yarakusani means who professes soothsayers. From then it came. And then we have, based on the mountain region, Kurinji. Kurinji is one section in the five types of Thinais that we see in Tamil tradition, Tolkapiyam, Kurinji, and Natak Kurinji, like that. And also we have something connected with Kannada. Kannada, Kannada Gowda, and then Navarasa Kannada, Kannada and Darbari Kannada, all from Karnataka. Karnataka Deva Gandhari, like that we have Karnataka. And Gandhari, Gandhara, such names. And again Trilinga, Tailanga, Tilanga, such from the Andhra Pradesh. So from every province, you have one or the other ragas, one or the other preferences. All are amalgamated and documented. And this is the wonder of Sanatana Dharma and India. So every raga, you see representation, whether it is folk or classical, we don't make any distinction. When we realize the beauty at the highest level, it becomes classical. When we prefer the regional choices, then it becomes Deshi. Deshi is the working is, and Marga is the theoretical completion. Both are present. And so also in movement. Jumping in the medieval text is called as Laga. In Kannada, even today, Laga means jump. And that has come from the Sanskrit word Laghu. Laghu, Laghu, Kshipramaram, Drutam, Amarakosha says. And then Dwada. Dwada is Dodda. Dodda in Kannada is big. Dwada Laga, Laga like that. Alaga, Alaga is again Laga. Because according to Tamil grammar, the words commencing with Ra and La cannot be uttered as they are. We have to add A or E to that. Ilangai, Iraman, Iravanan, Ilakkuvan, like that. So Laga, Alaga, like that. And Tiripa, Dalu. So many such terminologies they come. They have adopted all regional terminologies and they have made no disparity. That sense, everywhere you go, you see the totality of our art. So it is a dynamic equilibrium, not at all static and not at all oriented on class conflicts. Anywhere beauty that has to be adopted. That is what the great people of our tradition did, and our tradition acknowledged them. Not that they were mean people here and there, not that they did some malice, but our holistic tradition never acknowledged the mean, never relied upon them. They relied only on the great and noble who are all inclusive and all pervasive. Then we have the Kushala Kalas. I told about that. And then Krida Kalas. In Krida Kala, we have sports, very many types of sports. And both the indoor and outdoor we have. I shall deal with them in detail. And Yuddha Kala, martial arts. And Vanichya Kala, commercial. India since time immemorial was known for textile industry. And the art behind textile industry used to go by that. Vayana Kala, Tantu Kala, as we call, and even dyeing. The weaving, dyeing, printing, all these things were included. And then even we are well known for polishing the precious stones. Diamond cutting, diamond processing. Even today, India is one among the best, especially the Gujaratis. And all these things, Manikarma, every such thing can be seen. And then Sankirana Kala, not belong to any category like that. We have so many. We'll be dealing with some of them. Let me take. You can refer to some books like Fine Arts in Ancient India, Anil Bharam Ganguly, and then Kalas by A. Venkatesubbaiah, I told. Festival, Sports and Pastimes of India, wonderful book by Dr. V. Raghavan. Festival, Sports and Pastimes. It's published from Baroda. And then Shilpa Kalas in Sanskrit Literature, Ila Ghosh. And the great Hajari Prasad Vivedi has produced in Hindi, Prachin Bharat Ke Kalatmak Vinod. Everybody should read that. The work of Raghavan, Sports, Festivals and Pastimes, and also Hajari Prasad Vivedi's Prachin Bharat Ke Kalatmak Vinod, it's a wonderful journey in the world of beauty. And Hajari Prasad Vivedi, Acharya, was an embodiment of Indian culture. Those who know Hindi, they should never miss his works like Meghdoot Ek Purani Kahani, and Banabhattaki Atmakatha, and Kalidasaki Lalitya Yojana. Such works are amazing. And again I shall say, never go to English books in some of these things when you have great Indian writers writing in regional languages. Unfortunately, This study has not yet been made. How our Indian authors, writing in their mother tongues, they excel in giving high quality and high quantity works which are well rooted in our tradition and which are objective and yet compassionate. Any Western author, generally, he never connects with our tradition with an insider's compassion. It is always neutral. Neutrality is sterility, to say the least. There is nothing like non-allied. Either I have to join the good or bad. I abstain from voting. This is all aiding and allying with the bad. See, in the Mahabharata, we have clear indication of that. Krishna clearly says, declares, I am with the Pandavas. But Balarama is unable to. That neutrality is very dangerous. Ultimately, Balarama advocates Duryodhana. And he goes to Tirthayatra, a pilgrimage. I am unable to join any group. Both the groups are very close to me. So I abstain from the war and I will take up the course of Tirthayatra all along the course of Saraswati River. That's why he goes. Only one use is there. Because of Balarama's Tirthayatra, in the Sauptika Parva, we have details of Saraswati River. Thank God. But for those details, we would not have got that strong evidence that Saraswati was a living river by the time of Mahabharata. Almost at the place of Vinashana, it dried up, and again at Plakshaprasravana, it emerged out. But for that one use, which we have now, Balarama had no use in the Mahabharata. And on the 18th afternoon, he comes. When the dual combat with mace between Balarama, Bhima and Duryodhana is going on, he comes and ridicules, abuses Bhima and Krishna. For this, was it neutrality? No, it is not Balarama Marga, it is Krishna Marga that we need. In that sense, when we look into those things, our Indian authors, masters, not all, again I am saying, the best of the Indian authors, they are really, really much better than best of the Western authors. This is the equation with regards to our tradition and our culture, our arts. If you don't find any book on these things by Indian author, you can go to Western authors. Indian authors, especially writing in regional languages, because Indian authors writing in English is easily accessible to all. One, everybody can connect with Raghavan or Hiranya or Anand Kumar Swami. But it is difficult to connect with one Hajari Prasad Dwivedi, one D.V. Gundappa, or one Nori Narasim Shastri, or one Vishwanath Satyanarayana. It is very important. In that sense, we are so close and yet we are too far away. We know what's happening in English, but we don't know what's happening in Gujarati or Marathi or Bengali or Malayalam. This has to be done. It's a big task. Now, then Indian Entertainment by E.R. Salathore. These are some of the books which can be used. I shall read out some of the kalas, how variegated they are. I'm not going to read out all the list. You have anyhow the books. In the this literary arts, in fine arts, Lalita Kala, we have literary arts. In the literary arts, we have Kavya Kriya, writing poetry. And then Kriya Kalpa, appreciation of poetry, that is aesthetics of poetry, poetics, by that name we call Kriya Kalpa, older name of Kavya Mimamsa. And then Abhidana Kosha, Chando Vijnana, connected with lexicons and prosody. And then Deshabhasha Vijnana, you just see, among the 64 arts, Deshabhasha Vijnana means regional language knowledge. It's very important. And then Kavya Samasya Purana. One riddle-like line will be there. The other three lines will be supported, will be constructed, so that the riddle-like line will be fully meaningful. Shankar should have had explained that. Till now, he didn't got the opportunity to explain that. I shall give one small example from the same Bhoja Prabandha. Once Bhoja came to the court and just uttered gulu 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 gulu. Just some ridiculous sound, having no meaning, nonsense verse. ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು. ನೋಬಡಿ ಕುಡ್ ಸೇ ಎನಿಥಿಂಗ್. ದೆನ್ ಕಾಳಿದಾಸ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಯೂಶುವಲ್ ಸ್ಟುಡ್ ಅಪ್ ಅಂಡ್ ರಿಸೈಟೆಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ವರ್ಸ್. ಜಂಬೂ ಫಲಾನಿ ಪಕ್ವಾನಿ ಪತಂತಿ ವಿಮಲೇ ಜಲೆ ಕಪಿ ಕಂಪಿತ ಶಾಖಾಭ್ಯ ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು. ಬೋಜ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಗಾನ್ ಆನ್ ಹಂಟಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಹಿ ಸಾ ಎ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಲೇಕ್. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಸ್ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡಿಂಗ್ ಎ ಜಂಬೂ ಟ್ರೀ ಅಂಡ್ ಒನ್ ಮಂಕಿ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ಯೂಶುವಲ್ ವಿತ್ ಆಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಮಿಸ್ಚೀಫ್ ಇಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ಶೇಕಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಬ್ರ್ಯಾಂಚ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿ ರೈಪ್ ಫ್ರೂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಜಂಬೂ ವರ್ ಫಾಲಿಂಗ್ ಒನ್ ಬೈ ಒನ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ವಾಟರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಟ್ ಸೌಂಡ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಸೌಂಡ್ ಗುಳು ಗುಗ್ಗುಳು ಗುಗ್ಗುಳು. ಸೊ ಸಿಮಿಲರ್ಲಿ ಟನ್ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟಹ. ಎಗೇನ್ ವೆನ್ ಭೋಜರಾಜ ವಾಸ್ ಬೇದಿಂಗ್ ಒನ್ ಗರ್ಲ್ ಒನ್ ಅಟೆಂಡೆಂಟ್ ಬೈ ಮಿಸ್ಸಾರ್ ಶಿ ಮಿಸ್ಡ್ ದ ಗೋಲ್ಡನ್ ಬೌಲ್ ವಿಚ್ ಫೆಲ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಅರೇ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ಟೆಪ್ಸ್. ರಾಜಾಭಿಷೇಕೆ ಮದವಿಹ್ವಲಾಯ ಹಸ್ತಾಚ್ಯುತೋ ಹೇ ಮಘಟಸ್ತರುಣ್ಯ ಸೋಪಾನ ಮಾರ್ಗೇ ಪ್ರಕರೋತಿ ಶಬ್ದಂ ಟನ್ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟ ಟನ್ ಟ. ಒನ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಮೈ ಶತಾವಧಾನಂ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಲೀಲಾ ವಾಸ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ದೇರ್ ಇನ್ 91. ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು ವಾಸ್ ದಿ ಸಮಸ್ಯೆ ಗಿವನ್, ಬಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಸಾಲ್ವ್ ಇಟ್ ಇನ್ ಅದರ್ ವೇ. ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಪುರೇ ನಿತ್ಯ ಜಲಾಭಾವಾಭಿ ಬಾಧಿತೆ ರವ ಕದಾಪಿ ನಾಲೆ ಸ್ಯಾತ್ ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು ಗುಗ್ಗುಲು. ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಈಸ್ ನೋನ್ ಫಾರ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಸ್ಕೇರ್ಸಿಟಿ. ಸಮ್ಟೈಮ್ಸ್ ಸಮ್ ಹೌ ವೆನ್ ಯು ಓಪನ್ ದಿ ಟ್ಯಾಪ್ ದಟ್ ಸೌಂಡ್ ಗುಳು ಗುಗ್ಗುಳು ಗುಗ್ಗುಳು ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಹಾರ್ಡ್. ದಟ್ಸ್ ಹೌ ಐ ಕಂಪ್ಲೀಟೆಡ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ಸಮಸ್ಯಾ ಪೂರ್ಣ ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಧಾರಣಾ ಮಾತೃಕ ರಿಮೆಂಬರಿಂಗ್ ರಿಟೆನ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ವರ್ಸಸ್. ಪ್ರಹೇಲಿಕ, ಪ್ರಹೇಲಿಕ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ರಿಡಲ್ಸ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಪ್ರತಿಮಾಲ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಓಲ್ಡ್ ನೇಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಂತ್ಯಾಕ್ಷರಿ. ಅಂತ್ಯಾಕ್ಷರಿ ಆರ್ ಅಂತ್ಯಾಕ್ಷರಿ ಇಸ್ ಪ್ರತಿಮಾಲ. ಇಫ್ ಟೈಮ್ ಪರ್ಮಿಟ್ಸ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಡೇ ಆಫ್ ಫಿನಾಲೆ ವಿ ಶಲ್ ಶೋ ಹೌ ಪ್ರತಿಮಾಲ ವಿಲ್ ಗೋ ಆನ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಅಕ್ಷರ ಮುಷ್ಟಿಕಾ ಕಥನ. ಅಕ್ಷರ ಮುಷ್ಟಿಕಾ ಕಥನ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ದಿ ವೋವೆಲ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಗಿವನ್ ಬಟ್ ನಾಟ್ ದ ಕಾನ್ಸನೆಂಟ್ಸ್. ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಕಂಬೈನ್ ದೆಮ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮೇಕ್ ಎ ವರ್ಸ್. ಶಂಕರ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೈಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಇನ್ ಅವರ್ ಅವಧಾನಸ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಪರ್ಫಾರ್ಮ್ಡ್ ದಟ್. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ದ ವೋವೆಲ್ಸ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಗಿವನ್ ದೆನ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಕಂಪೋಸ್ ಅವರ್ ಓನ್ ವರ್ಸ್. ಐ ಶಲ್ ಗಿವ್ ಒನ್ ವೆಲ್ ನೋನ್ ವರ್ಸ್. ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಐ ಶಲ್ ಅಟ್ಟರ್ ದಿ ವೋವೆಲ್ಸ್. ಉವಾಂ ಆ ಆಂ ಏಂ ಶುಕ್ಲಾಂಬರಧರಂ ವಿಷ್ಣುಂ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಫಿಲ್ ಇನ್ ದಿ ಬ್ಲ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಸ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ದುರ್ವಾಚಕ ಯೋಗ ಟಂಗ್ ಟ್ವಿರ್ಲರ್ಸ್. ವೆರಿ ಡಿಫಿಕಲ್ಟ್ ಟು ಅಟ್ಟರ್ ಸಚ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್. ವಾಶ್ಚಾರ್ಡೇರ್ ಧ್ವಜ ಧಗ್ಧೃತೋಡ್ ಉಡುಪತಿ ಗ್ರೈವೇಯಕ ಬ್ರಾಡರ್ ವಾಶ್ಚಾರ್ಡೇರ್ ಧ್ವಜ ಧಗ್ಧೃತೋಡ್ ಉಡುಪತಿ ಟಂಗ್ ಟ್ವಿರ್ಲರ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ವಾತ್ಸ್ಯಾನಸ್ ಜಯಮಂಗಲವ್ಯ. ಹಾಂ ಎಕ್ಸಾಕ್ಟ್ಲಿ. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಮಾನಸಿ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಗಿವಿಂಗ್ ಲಿಪ್ ಮೂಮೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ದೋ ಐ ಆಮ್ ರಿಸೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್. ವೆನ್ ಸಂಬಡಿ ಈಸ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಟ್ರೈಂಗ್ ಟು ಇಮಿಟೇಟ್ ಬೈ ಲಿಪ್ ಮೂಮೆಂಟ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಕ್ರಿಯೇಟಿಂಗ್ ಎನ್ ಇಂಪ್ರೆಷನ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಆಮ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಆ್ಯಸ್ ದೋ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಮೈಂಡ್ ರೀಡಿಂಗ್ ಮಾನಸಿ. ಅಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಸಂಪಾಠ್ಯ. ಸಂಪಾಠ್ಯ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಜಾಯ್ನಿಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿ ಅದರ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ವೆರಿ ಈಸಿಲಿ. ಸೊ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಸಾಹಿತ್ಯ ಓರಿಯೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಸಂಗೀತ ಓರಿಯೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಗೀತ ವಾದ್ಯ ಪುಸ್ತಕ ವಾಚನ ವೀಣಾ ಡಮರುಕ ವಾದ್ಯಾನಿ. ಗೀತಂ ಯು ಆಲ್ ನೋ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಸಾಂಗ್, ವಾದ್ಯ ಪ್ಲೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೂಮೆಂಟ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ಪುಸ್ತಕ ವಾಚನ. ಪುಸ್ತಕ ವಾಚನ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ದ ಕಾವ್ಯ. ವೇರ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಕಾವ್ಯ ದಿ ಮೀನಿಂಗ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ಬಿ ಎಂಫಸೈಸ್ಡ್. ಇನ್ ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಎನ್ ಆರ್ಟ್ ಬೈ ನೇಮ್ ಗಮಕ ವಾಚನ. ಕ್ಲಾಸಿಕಲ್ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸಿಕಲ್ ಪೊಯೆಟ್ರಿ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಸಂಗ್ ವಿತ್ ಎನ್ ಎಂಫಸಿಸ್ ಮೋರ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ ಮೀನಿಂಗ್ ಬಟ್ ಮೆಲಡಿ ವಿಲ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಬಿ ದೇರ್. ಇನ್ ಆಂಧ್ರ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ವಾಚಕಮು. ಈವನ್ ಇನ್ ತಮಿಳ್ನಾಡು ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸಚ್ ಟ್ರೆಡಿಷನ್. ಎವ್ರಿವೇರ್ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದಟ್. ಇನ್ ನಾರ್ತ್ ಇಂಡಿಯಾ ತುಳಸಿದಾಸ್ ರಾಮಾಯಣ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಸಂಗ್. ಸೊ ದಿ ಟೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಓರಿಯೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್. ಇನ್ ಗೀತಂ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಮೋರ್ ಟ್ಯೂನ್ ಓರಿಯೆಂಟೆಡ್ ಮೆಲಡಿ ಓರಿಯೆಂಟೆಡ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವಾದ್ಯ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಬೋತ್ ಸಿಂಗಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಪ್ಲೇಯಿಂಗ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದೆನ್ ವೀಣಾ ಡಮರುಕ ವಾದ್ಯಾನಿ ಇಂಡಿಪೆಂಡೆಂಟ್ಲಿ ಪ್ಲೇಯಿಂಗ್ ದ ಮ್ಯೂಸಿಕಲ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೂಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್. ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್ ಎವ್ರಿ ವೀಣಾ ಪ್ಲೇಯರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ಟು ಸಿಂಗ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಮೃದಂಗ ಪ್ಲೇಯರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಟು ರಿಸೈಟ್ ದಿ ಬೋಲ್ಸ್. ದಟ್ ವಾಸ್ ದ ಟ್ರೆಡಿಷನ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಚಿತ್ರ ಆಲೇಖ್ಯ. ಆಲೇಖ್ಯ ಈಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ವೆರೈಟೀಸ್. ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಇನ್ ಚಿತ್ರ ದೆರ್ ಆರ್ ಸೆವರಲ್ ವೇಸ್. ವಿಷ್ಣು ಧರ್ಮೋತ್ತರ ಪುರಾಣ ಈಸ್ ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಫೈನೆಸ್ಟ್ ಟ್ರೀಟೇಸಸ್ ಆನ್ painting. We have others also, but it is the oldest. 6 types of chitras: rasa chitra, bhava chitra, vidha chitra, avidha chitra, dhuli chitra, nagara, vainika, like that. Many such varieties are seen. And then in shilpa, vastu vidya, that is architecture, takshakarmani, carpentry. And then we have in nritya, natya, nritya, where the theme will be enacted with details. The solo performance mainly, that is nritya, where dance, pure dance, that is nritya, is used to evoke story. It means that will be thematic, but it will be done with an elaboration so as to have a detailed way, something like an alapana. While applied dance to the level of theatre, where each and every character will be having particular costume, dialogue, everything, and then the story is more important than the interpretation, then it is natya or theatre. Will not be elaborating the details because the other character what to do. So it should be underplayed. The interpretation is underplayed and the story is overplayed. That becomes natya. When interpretation takes the forefront, then it is nritya. Though Bharata never speaks of nritya exclusively, and later texts say, this is how we can infer. Then nepatya prayoga. Nepatya prayoga is how to have the makeup, costumes, costume design. And then chalitaka, more or less the fancy dress. Chala means to deceive. Chalitaka is that. It is also said in Kalidasa, chalitaka means bringing out somebody's emotions as ours. Kalidasa mentions in Malavika Agnimitra, chalitaka is one of the most difficult things to do. Means emotions imitation is very difficult. This is what we do now in Padabhinayam, Padam, Javali and Dal. That is the best of dance, nritya. Kalidasa there mentions clearly in his Malavika Agnimitra how a Virahotkantita Nayika, Sharmishtha, wife of Yayati, will be depicting her pangs of separation. And then we have something like the amusements, Udaka Ghata, water sports, swimming. And then Sutra Krida. Sutra Krida means using a thread and playing so many things. Strings, using strings and doing lot of crafts like things. And then we have Dyuta. Dyuta Krida, Aksha Krida. You all know how fatally it ended. And then Akarsha Krida. Something like in Kannada we call that as Pagade. Dyuta and Pagade, they are different. And then Chaturanga, another one. And arranging cock fight, and then ram fight, bull fight, and other birds, Mesha, Kukkuta, Lavaka, Hudu, Ityadi, Nam Yuddha Vidhi. And then Hasta Laghava, that is the Indrajala, showing skill in the hands. And then Hasta Laghava is also termed as Chaurya, unknowingly burgling something. And then Nimitta Jnana, by listening to the sounds of birds and animals, inferring things. Vastra Gopana, hiding things and concealing. And then we have Malla Yuddha, Salamba, Dhanurved, Dhanurvidya, Khadgavidya, Ratha, Gaja, Ashva, Arohana, chariot race, and then horse riding, such things. And then Bahu Vyayama, and then Mushtibandha, Tarana. That is rowing. We all hear in Kerala, the race, boat race is too well known, such things. And then spasuna, spalana, that is playing with a ball. And then akshunna vedhitva, that is hitting the distant target, such things. Everything has sub-varieties and very many details. All these things I'm not going to. And then gandha yukti, this is all utilitarian arts. Perfumery, cosmetics, and we have Manikarma, Pushpashakatika. Pushpashakatika is floral arrangement. This is the great-grandfather of Ikebana. Ikebana is not first born in Japan. It is from India. Vatsyayana mentions clearly mentions Pushpa Shakatika, how to arrange flowers, Manikuttima Karma, how to make a good flooring, Vrikshayurveda, treating the plants with medicines, and cooking Supakarana. And we have many works devoted to cookery. Shankar has translated some of the works into English. Supashastra, Supavidya, and then Pakadarpana, and Kshema Kutuhala, Bhojana Kutuhala, like that, both veg and non-veg. Ours was not a muddy tradition. We have given every such detail. Then Vainayiki, connected with economics, Vaijayiki, Vyayamiki, Kalaha, martial arts, many, Indrajala Yoga, Chitrashva Yoga, all connected with magic, Vichitra Shaka Yusha Bhakshya Vikara Kriya. It is all about cookery, making that Panaka Rasa Raga Asava Yojana. How to make intoxicating liquors and also soft beverages, both hot and soft. In ancient India, plenty of drinking varieties were seen. Whether it is Paishti, Madhvi, Gaudi, Asava, Maireya, Kapishayini, like that n number of varieties are seen. Of course. And we have rules and regulations also for that. How they have to be fermented and how people has to relish that. Many things have been given. Because ours is not a very, very narrow-minded sectarian society. All cross-section of people were involved. Some people are preferred to do something. Some other people are shunned by thing only for different purposes like that. And we will not be getting the real picture of image, a real picture of India, when we look at some texts like Ramayana or Mahabharata alone. You have to see the Brihat Katha also. To know what was real India, you have to see the Brihat Katha, Katha Sarisagara, the Sanskrit version written by Somadeva, and also Buddha Swami Shloka Sangraha. I was very happy to find that work, Buddha Swami's Brihat Katha Shloka Sangraha, here in this library. Since many years I was searching for that, I haven't read it. But I don't know how. Sometimes I have to come here and sit and read. And then Kshemendra has done the Brihat Katha Sangraha, Brihat Katha Manjari in Sanskrit. That was the oldest Sanskrit version. And much older was earlier available, unfortunately lost. Many such thousands of manuscripts, versions were lost. A king by name Durvinita of Karnataka, who was the patron of Bharavi, the great poet, who succeeds Kalidasa in chronology, Durvinita wrote Sanskrit grammar and also wrote a wonderful Sanskrit translation of Brihat Katha, Deva Bharati Nibaddha Vadda Katha. And Dravidian culture is no way different from Sanskrit culture. There is nothing like Dravidian Aryan separation. And in Tamil, we have Perungatai, that is again Brihat Katha. Every such tradition is again connected with one great pan-Indian tradition. And then we have Pushpastarana, floral arrangement on ground, in water, and other things. That these are Alankarana Kalaha, cosmetic arts, Nepatya Prayoga, makeup, Shekharaka Pidana Sanyojana, how to have different types of headgears and floral headgears. Shudraka's Padma Prabhratakam, a classical bhana, one person, one heroine will be having, one character enters with Kokilaka Shekharaka. Kokilaka Shekharaka means, you know, the cuckoo, when it opens the wings, you can see white and black stripes below the wings. Like that, having a white silk piece of cloth and tying with the locks and tying it and shaping it in such a way that as though a cuckoo is sitting on the head, opening its wings, having the alternative stripes of black and white with the silk piece and all. In sculptures also we see Dr. Moti Chandra and Vasudev Sharan Agrawala, they have written the critical edition of that. For Vidushaka, Bharata also speaks about that. Many such headgears, if you go to Ajanta and Ellora, and also in the sculptures, traditional sculptures, you can see any number of Kesha Sanyojana, Bhushana Yojana, Bhushana Yojana, ornamentation, and Visheshaka Chedya. Visheshaka means Tilaka. How many types of Tilakas one can have? These varieties. And Karnapatra Bhanga, having different types of earrings, ear drops, and other things. Malya Grathana Vikalpa, floral garlands, many types of garlands. Pralamba, pralamba means long. And we have many types of jewels also, golden and pearl ornaments. If you have 100 strands, it becomes Devachanda. If you have 27, it will become Tarahara. If it is one single, it is Ekavali. Like that, many such things, Pratichanda, Devachanda, like that, many examples are given in Amarkosha. And then having the Rangolis, Tandula Kusuma Bali Vikara, having all the Rangavali varieties. And then train the pets, Shukasarika Pralapana, Shaina Rachana, arranging a neat bed, neat cart is also one art. Manibhumika Karma, Rupya Ratna Pariksha, Maniraga Akara Jnana, Gemology and Metallurgy, and Dashana Vasana Angaraga, perfuming the garments. They used to do fumigation, and also a cloth used to be taken, and the kneaded flowers will be covering, and another piece of cloth will be placed, and for few days that will be kept in cool but dry atmosphere. Then all the fragrance of the flowers will go to the clothes. Jati Kusuma Vasita Pravaraka. In Vrichakatika we have the hero Charudatta will be gifted with that by another person by name Churnavrdha. And then Suchivana Karma, tailoring and embroidery, needlework, what we call. Pattika Vetravana Vikalpana, that is the bamboo work and also the cane work, such things. These are all the utilitarian arts are crafts. And in Shukrinsara, even vessel washing is treated as one yukti, one kala. And even washing the clothes and playing with the children and babysitting, all these things are mentioned. So it goes. It's an infinite thing. If you go to ancient India, we forget ourselves. And some of the wonderful works on cultural study of ancient India are available. For example, the great Vasudev Sharana Grivala, one of the grandest personalities of Indian learning, has produced 3 books on cultural studies. 3 in Hindi, 1 in English, 1 translation of it. That is one connected with the days of Panini, India in Panini in English, and the enlarged version in Hindi, Panini Kali in Bharat, and Harshacharita Ek Sanskritika Adhyayan, Kadambari Ek Sanskritika Adhyayan, ultimately study of Banabhatta, one of the greatest prose masters of Sanskrit. One who studies Banabhatta will be knowing how great was India and how vivid and colorful was India. Here is my Saraswata Sahodari, Dr. S.R. Leela. Still one of her papers is lingering in my mind, that she presented about the colors present in Bana. Generally, we know in the English, Spencer is known for colors, the poet of colors, that's so they say. But in front of Bana is a child, is a baby, is an infant. In Bana, so many references to colors and so many combinations comes. One example I shall give, I'm so tempted to give at least that one. A dark complexion lady enters into the court of a king, and she will be covering her body with a veil, a thin silk veil, which is reddish in color. How she was looking like? When the sun rays in evening, when they fall on the dark blue lotus pond, how it looks like, so she was seen. Her body complexion is dark, dark blue lotuses. Neela Utpala, Neelotpala Vana. On that, the setting sun's bright red color rays, when they are falling, how she looks, so is the veiled body. The veil is in red color, very thin, translucent parda it is. In that way, he gives lot of beautiful references. And one parrot comes and it says, I consumed beautiful pomegranate seeds. How were they? There is a poetic convention, Kavisamaya, that elephant's temple region has pearls. If a furious lion breaks away, opens the temple region of an elephant, bites one claw's beat, then how all these pearls, which are soaked in blood, they emerge out and they fall out. Harinakara bhinna matta matanga matta matanga kumbhastha lotpatita raktardra mukta palatumshi dadimi bija rajimaham akhandayam, like that he says. You have to imagine beautiful pearls which are soaked in scarlet red blood. How they look like? So were the pomegranate seeds. That way of comparison, I had consumed jambu fruit juice. That's what he says, jambu phala rasam apibam. How was it? Amatta pumsko kila lochana chavi. An intoxicated cuckoo in spring season, how its eyes look like, in that color the juice was prepared. A very beautiful observation. We all know that kaka krishna pika krishna, that verse was also given. Crow and cuckoo, both are black in color, but the eyes of cuckoo are deep violet in color. That only close observation can make you know. I have seen it, and on that day I saw, I really, really enjoyed the poetry of Bana. Oh, what a great poet he is. How beautifully he observed all these things. Our poets were master observers. Like that, we have so many such references to Bana. And the cultural study of Bana has been done very beautifully, very scholarly way by Vasudev Sharan Agrawala. And also Bhagavat Sharan Upadhyaya's wonderful work, India in Kalidasa. Though his some of the basic assumptions like Aryan invasion are all wrong, but he was a very great scholar, and the cultural details what all he has given, tremendously good. And also the cultural study on Manasolasa, cultural study on Katha Sarasagara, cultural study on Gatha Saptashati, cultural study on Chaturbhani, these are some of the magnificent works which are produced mostly in Hindi. So I request the South Indians to learn Hindi, at least to read, enjoy and enrich for this purpose. In the same way, North Indians also should learn one of the South Indian languages, whether it's Kannada or Malayalam or Tamil or Telugu, so that they can become very good cultural bridges. Well, coming back to one more feature, that is art, artist and the genius. Please. How an art form like? Well, I told about the cock fight, bull fight, and then the ram fight. These are all part of the culture. I am not here to analyze the morality or not, but this is true. These were there, and they yet loved the animals also. We should not forget. Just because they fought with that, just because they treated within the courts cruelly, and how many people who are anti-jellicattu can nurture a cow or a bull in their flats? So before raising our voice, we should think in the other way also. See, our child we beat and we also cajole. I'm not advocating jellicattu, but the complexity of these things have to be seen. And our people, all these who are raising their voice against these, they are committed non-vegetarians. See, I am not at all against non-vegetarianism. I am a pure vegetarian, yet I respect the freedom of food. But my only contention is, people who raise their voice against animal atrocities, first they have to be like Jains, stringent vegetarians. How the Jain Munis and all, unless we practice to an extent, our voice will not become stronger. These are part of the culture. These are part of life. There is always himsa in the world. Himsa is natural and ahimsa is cultivation. And that's why in Sanskrit there is nothing like an independent word for ahimsa. The negation of himsa is ahimsa. Unlike satya, opposite of it is asatya. We have to manipulate to say untruth. We have to utter lie means we have to distort truth. Because satya is what? Very natural. Existence, reality. And then something other than that becomes unreal, that is falsehood. But himsa is natural in the world. We can only reduce it. We have to, for example, I am not for even elephants being misused in the name of festivals and other things and all, using all sorts of noisy crackers and all, baffling them and all. But at the same time, recently I had to address an elephant lovers gathering in Bangalore. Then I told that, yes, I am with you. But to what extent you are with this value? Here these complexities are there. That's why unless we have a total picture of that, we cannot do justice. This is what I mean. When I am saying these things, I am not ignorant of the darker side also. Jellikattu is one such example. There are many such. I am not saying that all these things should be brought forth. But as long as human being is there, violence is there. But we should not keep quiet. We should try to reduce it. But reduction can happen only by the all-round mechanism. To say one group should become non-violent and nothing to be said for the any other group and all that way of selective reaction, what is essentially being done nowadays in modern India, that's very dangerous and that will become counterproductive. And that will make the magnanimous people of open-mindedness also closed one, and they will also become reactionary. This unwarranted concern and selective reaction would make the well-meaning people also behave like fanatics. This adversary should always be taken care of. Okay? Now coming to the last aspect of it in theory, that is, sir, please. Vanichikala, that is Gandha Yukti, Manikarma, like that, Takshakarma, Daru, Daru Karma, Vastu Vidya, all these things, architecture, crafts, carpentry, and then diamond polishing, gold work, weaving, the needle work, all these things, they come under, all crafts, they end up here, but some of them are not even crafts. For example, Shainastarana, making the cot neat and preparing that is used in hotels. And also, you know, something like the Manikuttimakala, preparing the floor. In those days, cement was not available. The ground has to be polished, made level, polished neatly, and here and there, semi-precious stones will all be embedded. Such things will all go into the Vanijjikala. That's what I said. The overlapping is always there. This art will enter into the other one. And sometimes, a craft will be graduated to the level of art. Fine art. And a fine art will come down to the level of craft. Both will be happening. Such possibilities are also seen. And now coming to the definition of an artist. Please.
Just one observation is also that we have to remember the historical context.
Sure.
So the elephants used to be used in the war. If they're going to get startled with firecrackers, what will happen in war? So those kind of contexts, there are certain things developed. Now they are not being
used anymore,
it's a different matter. But we have to remember.
In those days, that's what I told, that in the gathering, I told, when the animals were in full utility, they used to be respected and loved also. This aspect we should never forget. It's a very complex thing. Now we need no more elephants for our day-to-day work. Then let us leave them in peace to an extent possible. And we have other alternatives also. We have from technology creating artificial elephants as well. And respecting them, loving them should not be a passive reciprocation towards them. Now coming to artist, kavi, Generally, we call any artist as Kavi. And our great God himself or herself is called as Kavi. In Vedas and in the Upanishads, the highest truth, God, is termed as Kavi. Kavir Manishi Paribhuhu, Kavi Krantadarshi. Like that, Jnani is also called as Kavi. God is called Kavi, Paramatman. And even the people who have released the Godhood, they are also called Kavis. And Kavi in general term. Kavru Varne is the root from which the word has emerged. Means that person who can reveal, who can narrate, who can recreate. I should recollect the words of Bhatta Tauta, the great mentor, scholar, who taught Abhinav Gupta Natyashastra. Unfortunately, his work, Natyashastra Vivarana, and also Kavya Kautuka, another work of Bhatta Tauta, both are missing. And even the commentary on Kavya Kautuka by Bhatta, by Abhinav Gupta, by name Vivarana, is again missing. These are the three works which are drastically missing. You know, by the here and there available quotations, we can reconstruct Bhatta Tauta, which I am doing now. There, he says, Nanrishik Kaviridyuktaha Rishishcha Kila Darshanat Vichitra Bhava Dharma Amsha Tattva Prakhyacha Darshanam Satattva Darshanadeva Shastreshu Patitakkavihi No Tathapi Darshane Swache Nitya Pyadikavir Munehe Nodita Kavita Loke Yavajjatana Varnana Prajnana Vanon Meshe Shalini Pratibhamata Tadanu Pranana Jivad Varnana Nipunakavihi Smritir Vetita Vishaya Matiragami Gochara Buddhist Tatkaliki Gneya Prajnatrikaliki Mata Prajnana Vanon Meshe Shalini Pratibhamata Tadanu Pranana Jivad Varnana Nipunakavihi. These are some four verses which Hemachandra and then Ruyaka, these are all quoting in their works. I shall give out the meaning. He who is not, or he means she also. Because we got used to this way of expression, that's why no gender bias. That person, for your kind information, I am the most well-meaning feminist first. I am a feminist and very well-meaning feminist. Because artists are always feminists. Art is feminine in reality. Expression is always feminine and experience is masculine. Vakrata is feminine both in gender and in quality. And rasa in gender and quality masculine. So we artists are always feminists. Our work is more in representation, in bringing out vakrata. So that person, unless he becomes a rishi, he cannot be a poet. Nanrishi Kaviritukta. This is what we treat as an artist. Nowadays, in the name of art and being artists, writers or whatsoever, how they behave, you know. And what is our standards which our acharyas have made for? Nanrishi Kaviritukta. Rishishcha Kila Darshana. Anyone cannot become Rishi. Nowadays, so many people are there just by adding the prefix or suffix Rishi. One and all are becoming Rishis. They have channels, they have books, they have ashramas and whatnot. No. One cannot declare oneself as Rishi. The whole creation respects him as Rishi. Rishishcha Kila Darshanat. He should have a vision. And vision is not hallucination. Vichitra Bhava Dharmamsha Tattva Prakhyacha Darshanam. One of the finest lines in the whole range of Sanskrit literature, this is. The definition of Darshana. What is Darshana? Vision. Vichitra means astoundingly different. Bhava Dharmamsha. The sustainable nature of emotions being synthesized. Tattva Prakhyacha Darshanam. He who can synthesize the apparently divergent, realistic and emotional existences into one harmony. And that is called darshan. Vichitra bhava dharma amsha tattva prachya. Unity is not in nature. Unity is what we have to realize in our hearts. The world cannot become one. That type of oneness of the world can only be thought in eternal deluge, ultimate deluge. Only in pralaya everything will become one. But the oneness has to be raised within us. The existence will be diverging, and the complementary nature of existence has to be realized by us. And that is profoundly done in our tradition. I can boast, in no other tradition we have this much of integrity of vision in all walks of life. Here and there in other traditions there may be such glimpses, but whether it is cookery or whether it is poetry or whether it is theater or war or penance or nature or agriculture or whatsoever, everywhere you have that. That's why it is not accidental. It's innate and it's not blind. It's completely aware of itself. Vichitra bhava dharmamsha tattva prakhyacha darshanam satattva darshanadeva shastresho patitakkavi. According to our shastras, he who has or she who has this darshana will become artist just by the vision itself. And that's why Rajashekhara says, sarvo api hrudaye kavihi. All are poets and artists in their heart. For ourselves, we are artists. But in the loka, so Valmiki, just by the vision itself, just by the tapas itself, he was kavi. Kincha, nodita kavita loke yavajjata navarnana. But unless this is brought out in the form of an art, expressed, the world will not accept. Many people say, we have many ideas. Please bring out. We don't offend anybody. Bring out. I have so much to say. Please say. I can write. Well, write. I can sing. Please sing. So because many people just trying to snub something, we too have a lot of imagination. We can also do so many beautiful things. Well, do it. Once in our group, one great author was invited. One among our group members, oh, we have lot of imagination, we too can write. The great writer, with all modesty and conformity, said, yes, but when you take paper and pen, all your imagination will dry up after a page itself. It's not easy. Just because I know language, I can't write poetry. Just because I have a voice, I can't sing. Just because I have hands, I can't dance. It needs training. It needs cultivation. It needs practice. That's what we knew. Pratibhav, yutpatti, abhyasa, all are important. So, satatva darshana deva shastresho patitakkavihi. That oneness of realization itself will make him a kavi in the shastric sense. But for the acceptance of the world, nodita kavita loke yavajjatana varnana. Kavuru varne, it has to be revealed out in all its vividity. The vividness is very, very important. And then he also says, smritir vyatita vishaya. Memory is always of the past. And then anticipation is mati. Anticipation is always futuristic in nature. And intelligence, buddhi tatkaliki jnaya. Smritir vyatita vishaya, mati ragami gochana, buddhis tatkaliki jnaya. Intelligence is always contemporary and is in present tense. But prajna, it pervades past, present and future, and it's all pervading. Prajna trikaliki mata, and such vision which can transcend the barriers of space and time. So future, past, present, everything are seen well. And if that pratibha can see newer and newer things, can reveal newer and newer things, prajna navanava unmesha shalini pratibha mata, then it is called pratibha. Pratibha means repeated brilliance, repeated flash. That flash is not once shining and completely withdrawing, completely vanishing and fading away into darkness. Know that every moment it has to shine, constantly shining. Something like a Kohinoor or a hope, or a Jacob diamond being kept behind a lamp, every time when you turn around, various angles of cutting will reveal various flashes of brilliance. That is what is pratibha. And that prajnana vonvesha shalini pratibha mata tadanupranana jivat varnana nipunakkavihi. And that should become the lifeline of an artist. Then he or she is called as an artist. Pratibha is very, very important. Tatra nirmala pratibhanavan kavihi. That's what we say. So, to become an artist, first we should have the flash of looking at new. Imaginative. Kalpana nipunaha. That is very, very important. Kalpa means creation. That creativity, constantly creating newer and newer things, that should be the nature. And then only an artist will be an artist. Because many times, the people who have been initiated to classical, I think, why am I not a singer? Yes, you are a singer, but an artist, but not an artist. To become an artist, you have to reveal something new. Just singing the age-old same song, that is not real art. You have been protecting art, learning art. To become an artist, some difference, and that is not just the difference, it is the positive difference that is very important. Many people in the name of variety do something nasty, nonsense. No. It should be constructively different, positively different, and enjoyably different, enchantingly different, and elevatingly different. These are all very, very important. That's so the Pratibha Vyapara and our tradition has never, never branded any person as Nastika and so has no Pratibha. And he is Jain or Buddhist and Shaivite and Vaishnavite and so no Pratibha. No, like that. Never an artist has been branded based on his beliefs. And that's why a poet from the Buddhist lore, Dharmakirti, a great champion of Buddhist logic and Buddhist philosophy, his verses have been added into various Subhashita Sangrahas. He's a good poet and incidentally has written wonderful free verses. Free verses means muktakas, pearl-like verses about love, viraha and dan. A very beautiful bunch of verses. And also a Jain poet like Ajit Sena or Jinasena or Gunabhadra, so many people are there. My mentor, Vidwan Yanrangath Sharma, used to say, after Valmiki Ramayana, to see the beauty and lucidity of diction in Anushtup meter, you have to go to Jinasena's Purva Purana. And in our Alankarika Granthas, in our works on aesthetics, we have profuse references to all poets, belong to all categories. So, all these people, irrespective of their gender, creed, class, regionality, a poet hailing from the community of Mahouts, people who train elephants, supposed to be not from the Brahmin class, Bhartramenta is treated as best and almost on par with Kalidasa. Unfortunately, his work, Hayagrivavadha, is lost. Like that, we have many poets, Dhavaka. We don't know which are the poems he has written, but he is treated as a good poet. Dhavaka means he is hailing from the washerman's community. Like that, we have all types of poets hailing from all communities, and also aestheticians hailing from all communities, all strata of society, whether women or men, whosoever, from various parts of India. And many people, they have one question: does Sanskrit aesthetics is Indian aesthetics? Bharatiya Kavyamsa is Sanskrit Kavyamsa? No. It is Bharatiya and Sanskrita. Sanskrita and Bharatiya. We are using Bharata and Sanskrita synonymous and we need no apology for that. Because when Bhamaha from Kashmir is writing on aesthetics and discussing some points, the same points are critically evaluated by Dandi in Kanchipuram, remote south. And the same ideas of Dandi are again analyzed by Bhamaha in the same way. And Bhamaha and Dandi are poles apart in some of the ideas. But Dandi finds a wonderful successor in Kashmir in the name of Vamana. And in the same way, one author like Bhoja, hailing from central India, Dhara, if he has some idea, those ideas are supported by a scholar like Sharada Taniya from south, from again Kanchipuram. And then Vedas, which are revealed in Brahmavarta, that is the area between Saraswati and Dashadvati, which is now the Kurukshetra. These Vedas are commented upon mainly by the South Indians, that is Bhattabhaskara or Mahidhara or Venkatamadhava or Uvata or Sayana, the great Sayana who gave commentary to all these. And also the Badarayana of Badri, he got all commentaries from South. A Kannada person, Madhvacharya, a Tamil person, Ramanujacharya, a Malayalam person, Shankaracharya, an Andhra person, Vallabhacharya, and another Andhrite, Nimbarka. All are from South India, they are writing. So, we have no such regional bias also. In any science, in any art, we see that Bharata from North India, perhaps Kashmir, got wonderful commentaries from different areas of India and also from Kashmir. But his works, Abhinav Gupta's commentary, were preserved in Kerala. A scholar in economics and polity, multifarious scholar and a great luminary, one of the grandest sons of our land, hailing from Magadha, the northeastern part of India, Kautilya, who had studies in northwestern part of India, Takshashila, his works were preserved intact in Kerala. And also, a northwestern scholar, the greatest of great Acharya, Bhagavan Panini, he got his commentary from the northeastern part, Vararuchi, and also from the central India, Bhagavan Patanjali, and from northern India, Kayata, and from southern India, Maharashtra, Nagesh Bhatta, who wrote for Udyota. Such way, every concept has been critically analyzed and also approached by different people, by different parts of India, without any regional bias. Andhra Brahmin, South Indian, Annam Bhatta, got so many commentaries from other parts of India as well. Tarka Sangraha, that we see. And the South Indian Acharyas got so many North Indian commentators, North Indian followers. Like that, we see that homogeneousness. And Shargadeva, who hailed from Kashmir, came to central India and settled in Aurangabad. Earlier it used to be called as Devagiri. And there, he got his commentary in South India, that is in Vijayanagar, we have Mallinatha, Kallinatha, who wrote Sangeeta Kalanidhi, and another South Indian belonged to Andhra, Rajakunda, then Singhabhupala, who wrote the Sangeeta Sudhakara commentary, like that. Thousands and thousands of examples to show, and nowhere we have regional bias, nowhere we have bias of caste and creed. In that sense, Indian aesthetics, whether it is written in Sanskrit or Prakrit or anywhere, it is Indian aesthetics and mainly written in Sanskrit. And Sanskrit is not the language of one region, one caste, one creed, one community. This we can see from Anvaya and Vetireka. Both the ways we can see. And that's why people who blame by having wrong names with all ulterior motives should be shunned without batting our eyelashes. Just as a reflex action, we have to answer them. We need not be bitter, but we should be very, very critical, and we should spare no words to oppose their wrong biases, wrong views, and highly perverted biases. With this, I shall stop, and in the remaining sessions, let me do something with the heart of Indian art is seen in so many aspects. But all should go to the three great, Vyasa, Valmiki and Kalidasa, where we can see the raw material as well as the end material of art. Okay?